The question is about the speculation that we bombed North Vietnam in order to goad China into coming into the war so we could smash China's nuclear installations. There is a great deal of talk in military circles, I'm sorry to say, in Washington about smashing China. And it's very terrible and very criminal and very foolish and very mad, in my opinion. We can't smash China. We can't smash that big a part of the human race. And if we wipe out her nuclear installations by pinpoint bombing, she'll rebuild them in 10 or 15 years or 5 years or 10 years. This is the tick of the clock in the life of a great people like China. We have to come to terms with China. But I don't think the bombing of North Vietnam is due to that. I think the bombing of North Vietnam was a response of exasperation and frustration. And since we couldn't defeat the guerrillas on their own terrain, we wanted to use this tremendous weapon of ours, our Air Force and our bombing, to flex our muscles and to change the war from a war we couldn't win to a war we could win.
Stein?
The gentleman says that Professor Scalapino made a very sophisticated and intelligent exposition of the bombings of North Vietnam and claimed that we were doing it in order to split Hanoi from China and the Soviet Union from China. Is that right? I think this is much too sophisticated. No people yet have surrendered under bombardment. What kind of nonsense is it to think that the North Vietnamese are any different? Nobody surrendered. The Spanish didn't surrender. The British didn't surrender. The Germans didn't surrender. The Russians didn't surrender. Nobody has surrendered under bombardment. This is a delusion of the Air Force. Look, there are very real differences between Hanoi and Peking and Moscow. A shrewd and subtle diplomacy could play upon them to get a viable settlement. But the kind of crude diplomacy that we are using, it just defeats itself. None of these three can sell out the other or the Viet Cong. There are differences there, and the differences are deepened. But that doesn't mean we're going to win them over to our side. We talk about, a lot of our people say, well, if we get out of Vietnam, that'll prove the Chinese are right and the Russians are wrong. It'll prove that you resist the United States, it's a paper tiger. Why talk about peaceful coexistence? Well, I don't know about the argument. What we did in the Dominican Republic has been a bigger help to China than any victory in Vietnam. What we did in the Dominican Republic was to tell the youth and the poor people of Latin America that democratic promises couldn't be trusted, that the Alliance for Progress was a lie, that Johnson was stripping away the benevolent parts of it that Kennedy had imposed, and there was no hope in working with us. That's a very terrible message, a very terrible signal. The bombing can increase competition between Moscow and Peking. We have to find our way to peace with China. There has to be peaceful coexistence. Sure, the Chinese are difficult, but why shouldn't they be difficult? We've outlawed them, we've embargoed them, we've tried to strangle them. Now look, the Chinese have tremendous assets. Look around you, look around the world at some of the revolutions in some places I won't mention. Because I don't want to reflect on anybody. The Chinese, first of all, have got the asset of a tremendously industrious people. Do you know what that means? Have you ever seen a revolution in a backward country? You can have all the damn rhetoric you want. If people are not used to working hard, you can holler socialism all you want to. It doesn't do much good. But in China, you have a tradition and a habit and a conditioning of industry. And secondly, you have a deep and old civilization, and the task of transplanting to the problems of modern science, the analytical habits of mind, the respect for learning that were applied to Confucian classics is very easy. Overnight, those same intellectual qualities can be applied and are being applied. And this is why China has developed a bomb so quickly. And thirdly, you have the tremendous motivating power of the humiliation of a great people for 100 years by Western powers. You know, the Jews haven't forgotten Haman, and the Irish haven't forgotten Cromwell. The Opium Wars are only 100 years ago, when for the sake of profit we tried to debauch the Chinese people with opium. Put these three things together under a fresh revolutionary regime that has shown its mettle. Look at the difference between the way food shortages have been handled in India and how they were handled in China. Open your eyes to the reality. There's a lot of things about that Chinese government I don't like. I don't like Stalinism. I don't like cult of personality. I don't like thought control. I want to see these things change, but they're not going to be changed by war. We have to recognize that China will be the greatest country in the world within a century, no matter what we do. We have to live with them in fraternity and in peace and in understanding and in appreciation. And since we began the cycle of hatred and the feud, we have to be the first ones to extend the hand of friendship. Let them reject it if they want to.